come out of you. It came out with guilt in you. And the reason why guilt is here, why don't you live in guilt and shame? Guilt is because it's out of you. Guilt is out of you. Don't do it. You don't have to live in fear. You don't have to live in shame. You don't have to live in guilt. Your sins are forgiven. You don't have a right to stand in with God. Revelation is a powerful thing in our consciences. That Jesus died in the penalty of our sins. It was a criminal. The reason we have a criminal is already in the penalty of our sins. And we have to have forgiveness. Everybody in our Jesus changed this. It hasn't been cooking, you've committed a crime. You've committed a crime. Guilty, and you have to be sent to jail. Let's say you've been sent to jail for 2 years because you're guilty of something. Will you be held in prison for those 2 years? I never know that finally your guilt, the debt that you owe to a justice system, which is 2 years, I never know that that debt is fully paid. I never know that you fully covered the sins that you did. I never know. When the doors of your prison cell is open to say, you're finally free to go. You finally paid the tears. You finally paid the price that you were paying for. When your doors are open and you can walk out, that's the real. The way you can say, the way you can say, is God. And the we don't have to live in sin and guilt is connected to our past or whatever we've done. Or whatever we're going through. It's truly pain. God's telling the resurrection, this payment is enough. You never have to pay for these things again. Never. The resurrection is yours. And the resurrection is not just like our sins are paid for. Just about the freedom of sin, but the freedom to live a resurrected life. Not just be forgiven, but empowered to live. We can now live. We can now live to love, to serve, to advance the kingdom, to be generous, to live a countercultural life. gain, we gain forgiveness, but we also gain a meaningful life. Which is why I'm because if because of God's grace, our faith is in vain. But if Christ has been raised, our faith is not in vain. Our faith is real. Our faith is worthwhile. Our faith is profitable. If you don't have the dead, it's not going to be a to give the end of the world to the Lord Jesus. The Lord says, hey, you don't raise us. Fine, but why are you doing it? But if you give me that, which is true, you can then raise up the dead for us. The person of the dead, we're going to give it to the Lord Jesus. It's always coming up to the power of the kingdom of God. Because Christ has been risen from the dead. And some of us, we live our lives as if Christ is dead. We're living our lives as if the faith is in vain. What the Lord is doing at the end of this chapter is when he's getting into a very simple and extremely important question. He's going to say, it's okay, this is what we're doing for us. Be steadfast. Always abounding the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. Listen, Christ is risen. He's still fast. He's a beautiful. He's a beautiful. He's a beautiful. Maybe I feel your labor is not in vain. Yes, of course, this is my question. Not this way. It's so sad when you see Christians just laboring in life. Laboring and laying in their lives, giving wholehearted devotion to the mission of God as if Christ is dead. Treating Christianity as just another extra in our lives. Just an extra. You know, when you talk about yourself, I'm a father, I'm a husband, I'm an accountant, I'm a hiking, I'm not traveling, oh, I'm also a Christian, I don't just now and then when I get back. Really? Has Christ risen? Has Jesus done anything in your life? Look what Paul says in verse 32. He says, what is the joke I mean? He was truly speaking, and I thought with great effort, and he says, I went through a lot. And what have we for? I went through a lot of great effort. Is the joke I mean? That's it. Change for tomorrow day. You see that? What are you doing for doing all of this? I just kind of boost in Ephesus. I went to the point. It was because of the name of Jesus. You know what I'm going to do? Let's eat. Let's drink for tomorrow day. Let's eat our way. Let's do all we can and care all we get. But there's nothing to it. That's what I'm going to do. That's what I'm going to do. And I'm going to do it. But if the truth is empty, if the truth is empty, then everything changes. I can abandon my life. I can live my life. If I'm going to do it, then the truth is empty. This Christ is risen. We can live our lives with a purpose and meaning bigger than us. Bigger than us. That's the ramification of a risen Jesus. He changes everything. It's a dominant. And I feel like if this is not true, that's a drinking bread. And I'm afraid that some Christians, some people, live as if it's not true. They're eating and drinking and dying. And I feel like it's not wrong with eating and drinking. It's just like that's all you do. It's all about that. What is about that? Your life is one big prayer. Your life is one big vacation. purpose. Be in it. Be in it. God can change our condition. And the answer is yes. What do you have? If some of us say, how about this? Death is a life lived in light of Jesus. Where do you want to go? Where do you want to serve? What do I do? This is the gift you've given me. How do I advance the kingdom with those? We can't live our lives as if Christ is dead. And this is the beginning of living hope. We do live in living hope. Which is what Paul says to Jesus, but it's not Christ helps him raise from the dead, the people from those who have fallen asleep. When Jesus raised from the dead, he gave us the first fruit. You know, the first fruit is almost like in William Jones, it would be not only how to release a new phone or whatever, it would give like a, it would be a, what do you call the phone that comes first? It's like a, the demo. You know, here's the phone, this is what it's going to look like, and then they're going to release the album later. We also get a promise of resurrected life. Lose the resurrection, lose the hope. Gain the resurrection. It's not a wishful thinking, not a hope. It's a living hope. The final fall, which is death. Jesus. And on that there will be a final coffin on that. But the resurrection means that the evil realm has been defeated on the cross and vindicated by the resurrection. You should be destroyed by the life of Christ. The resurrection has changed everything. He has defeated death. You know the story of the Battle of Waterloo in England. In the war of the Battle of England and France, and England was represented by the general Linton, and France was represented by the army. And he said that, you know, on the battle, they would have to wait for their leaders, wait for their generals to come back and report. Won the battle. And as it was happening, in those days, there was no, you know, internet or whatever, you could just give the message, we have on the back of oil, so they would have these lights that would give a message on, you know, from life that would sort of cry the message on my father. So it's like a validity for the message to say who's winning this battle. And then on the day when the message was being given, it was a full day, people couldn't really see, and they could see the lights coming. And they could see the lights coming, it said, Wellington defeated. And people in the English side, they were very sad, you know, that Wellington defeated. They're all sad, they're all wondering what's going to happen. But it's still treated. In fact, the sentence was not finished. Wellington defeated Napoleon. And it's almost like on Good Friday on the cross. Paul said when Jesus was hung on the cross, he died. He was buried on the tomb. The disciples fled. Everybody went down. But if you remember, we still talk to you before. These disciples are walking in the road of Emmaus, and Jesus comes to them. And they say to him, "Don't you know what happened? The one that we thought would be the hope of the world, he did." It was almost like on that time when Jesus died like that. So that message is special. I'm very uncomfortable. The message is for you. Tempted to really click because it's just such a big thing to be on. I want to say, if you're not a Christian, the chain that Jesus was on can change. If you are a Christian, then the resurrection is key. The narrative of the social contract, whatever the narrative is about you, whatever the narrative of all your life is happening in this world, does not define you. Whatever this country, whatever this social contract we live in, has sort of made you, it does not define you. Failures do not define you. It's not the end of the story. In fact, Christ you for.